Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Food Roots, Growing Bananas in Iceland, and Other Tales from the Logistics of Eating, by Robyn S. Metcalfe, narrated by Donna Postel. Introduction. In 1994, my family moved from Silicon Valley to mid-coast Maine. We left monotonous sunshine for capricious, complicated weather. We had just spent a year in England and returned to California, inspired by Britain's rural landscape. So inspired, in fact, that we moved to Maine and bought a farm. But not just any farm. We had seen the farms in England that raised historic, rare livestock breeds, and we decided to follow suit. Ours was a conservation farm with a mission to increase the populations of historic livestock breeds in North America. The move seemed like a random impulse, and it was, sort of. But it was consistent with our desire to trade the indulgent lifestyle in Silicon Valley for an unknown adventure in the liminal landscape that lies between Maine's coast and its languishing agricultural interior. With our two young children, we set up a working farm that would raise heritage livestock as a conservation project. The idea was to increase agricultural biodiversity by raising farm animals that represented genetics that were rapidly disappearing from farms around the world. More genes meant more resilience and redundancy for our food system. Rare livestock breeds survive in dwindling, fragile populations. But by increasing their numbers, we would strengthen and diversify the safety net in case the few commercial breed populations we all rely on ever collapse. Although many of our livestock breeds were no longer commercially sustainable, we thought they might be of interest to a few chefs who thrived on new, scarce ingredients for their menus. We were optimists. We ran the farm for 10 years, soldiering on during long, blustery New England winters. Grocery store managers and chefs in our town were skeptical. Our closest high-end restaurant bought lamb from New Zealand, but not from our farm 3 miles away. We did succeed on other fronts. We re-established Gloucester Old Spots pigs in North America after the breed population had dwindled to only 4 animals. Now the breeding population is about 200 in the United States. Still fragile, but at least still on the map. We also established heritage breed programs on many other U.S. farms while introducing them to chefs in the Northeast. After 10 years of operation, the farm's model, based on small populations of animals, was unsustainable. So we paused our efforts to bring attention to dwindling agricultural genetics. We eventually sold the farm, passing on the animals we'd raised to other farmers who we had encouraged to conserve heritage breeds. Our project was too much, too soon. Today, heritage breeds are on the menu, and small farmers find the interest in local and sustainable brands helpful in terms of positioning their products. We have a greater understanding of our food system and a full-bodied language to describe it. When we operated our farm, no one talked of local or sustainable food. Timing is everything, as Daniel Pink says in his book, When. 10 years after closing the farm, I began teaching food history at the University of Texas at Austin. It was time to think critically about our food system, and it was finally time to find out why that restaurant in Maine wouldn't buy our meat. The timing of this project was better, but finding the answer has taken longer than expected. We talk all the time about new ways of growing or eating healthy food, but we still don't know much about how we get food to our tables. The answer to why restaurants don't routinely buy ingredients from local sources lies somewhere between the farmer and the chef. In 2011, I organized a project called Food and City, to explore how we feed our cities. This book is a product of our work at Food and City, digging into the two of farm to table. You'll find out about this invisible stretch of our food supply chain in this book. But here's a hint about why our food doesn't always travel in logical ways from farm to plate. New Zealand produces grass-fed, uniform lamb all year long at a fraction of the cost of our farm's lamb in the United States. We are witnessing major changes in the way we grow, process, transport, and consume food. Each change that occurs within our global food system sends ripples throughout the supply chain, up and down, back up to the producer, and back down to the consumer. These changes will result in getting better food to more people, while lessening the waste and environmental impact along the way. Networked digital tools will both improve our food system and challenge our relationship to food in new ways, not always with positive results. We need to recognize this tension and anticipate our response to the increasing use of technology in our food system. Who are we? Most likely, the listeners of this book are able to afford to think about where their food comes from, the environmental impact of our global food supply chain, and the problems related to food waste. The food system at the heart of this book is not so privileged. We will investigate the global food supply chain in the broadest sense, feeding 90% of the world's population, and not just the readers of Eater, the members of Slow Food, and those of us who Instagram our latest foraged dishes. The food system at the heart of this book needs reinvention, maybe even a total redo, in order to provide enough healthy food to the entire world population now and in the future. We have an opportunity now to use the technological advances available to make impactful changes in the way we grow and distribute our food. I'm a technology optimist, but I am cautious about how we use technology when it comes to our food system. The optimism comes from our experience producing our annual Food and City Challenge Prize, a competition for entrepreneurs who are starting businesses in the area of food logistics. Applications for the competition increase every year. That's reason enough for optimism. But as we move toward blockchains, robots, and engineered food, we should keep a wary eye on all the complications they engender, especially when food is involved. We can use technology to improve our financial system or to deliver curated content easily enough. But food goes into our bodies. It can kill us if we let it. And it is all very, very personal. We get all fired up over our grandmother's apple pie or our town's world-famous chili, in spite of the carbon footprint of the ingredients. Our food tells the world who we are. Will changing our food system change who we are? Or are we changing in ways that will shape the future of our food system? The purpose of this book is to challenge our current assumptions about our global food system and to explore what the future might look like. We've grown accustomed to talking about our food system in terms of opposing values: big food, small farmers, global food supply chains, and local food. Almost every narrative about our food settles into one of these tendentious camps. The latest technological advances are loosening up some of the barriers that have impeded progress toward change. We are challenged, more than ever, to reconsider our attitudes towards science, art, and what it means to be human. We've been here before. When the industrialization of food occurred in the early 20th century, reformers and consumers welcomed lower food costs and an increase in both the variety and the quantity of food. it wasn't until later that the public realized the effects of a centralized food system that relied on synthetic chemicals and artificial flavors. We're about to get what we wish for again. New digital tools will allow us to follow our food throughout the supply chain, and engineers will make new proteins that may make juicy steaks a thing of the past. Will it take us too many years to realize that transparency can be misused by bad actors? And the elimination of animal-based protein can result in an imbalance in our domestic food production landscape? Our global industrialized food supply chain has gradually changed the way we grow, process, and deliver our food. Industrialization brought us to a moment of reconsideration, and we're there again, in an even bigger way, now that the digital revolution has arrived, causing humans to weigh the benefits and costs of being connected through our smartphones. While we want healthy food we can trust, we also want personalized food and lots of choices. We want the peaches from the farmer next door, 100 types of bread, fiddleheads from the forest, and dozens of coffee options. We want small, beautiful, slow food, at the same time as we want inexpensive, fast, predictable food. The question of how to develop this all-inclusive supply challenges even the most nimble and precocious food systems planners. We will need computers, networks, and software to satisfy all of our needs and desires. Could it be that the world already produces enough food and will continue to do so, and the critical problem is one of distribution? Might we make a dramatic reduction in food waste if we could just distribute more of what we already produce? Maybe these digital tools can help stop the bleeding of food within our global supply chain. The subject of the movement of food is complicated by the challenge of gaining access to resources that are bound by confidentiality, intellectual property, and the connections between food security, transparency, and national security. Not everyone in the food distribution system is keen to have their protocols, sources, and future plans made public, particularly when their space is becoming ever more unstable and subject to disruption. As Amazon, Google, and Uber join traditional players like Cisco, U.S. Foods, and Aramark, competition for new services makes the innovators even more guarded about their plans for the future. Traditional concerns about openness and collaboration make it more difficult to get closer to an understanding of how our food supply chain works now, so that we can intelligently apply new digital tools to solve its many problems. This is changing, but trust on both the consumer and producer sides will come only gradually, nudged forward by an impatient market. You'll find four themes throughout all six chapters in this book: reliability, technology, trust, and adaptability. Our food supply chain depends upon reliable quantity, quality, and schedules. Without technology for production, processing, distribution, and transportation, the supply chain would fail to keep up with our growing global urban population. Without trust between the source, the consumer, and everyone in between, more of our food would end up in landfills. And without the ability to adapt to change and disruptions, our food supply chain would fail. Our supply chain operates on these four ingredients. You may find this book's overview of our global food supply chain incomplete. The focus of these chapters is to give a brief overview of how the food supply chain works, while describing the changes occurring today and suggesting how they might impact us going forward. Treat this flyover as a primer to the mechanics and dynamics of the subject, and use it to find your way to more specialized books about supply chains and food logistics. You will also notice the absence of the expected ethical criticisms of our global food supply chain. We're increasingly aware that the food system can appear unjust, insecure, toxic, and exploitive, and that healthy food is simply inaccessible to much of the world. While these observations are valid, they are not the focus of this book. Instead, we'll explore the unexplored, the invisible people operating to feed our cities around the world, the unknown impact of new technologies on the food system. This will be new territory for many of us. Intended to introduce you to the people and technology that deliver our food from farms to plates, this book begins with a general description of how the food supply chain evolved and how it works today. You should feel uncomfortable with some of the material in this book. Yielding the image of verdant fields of organic tomatoes for enclosed high-rise greenhouses controlled by robots may rattle many of us who feel grounded in soil-grown food. Chapter 1 moves up and down the chain and back and forth through time, stopping along the way to reveal a little science and a little art and spontaneous adaptation. We'll provide a summary of the basic elements that allow our food supply chain to feed cities around the world. At no other time have consumers thought of the quality of their meals in terms of location the way they do now. So Chapter 2 sets the global food supply chain in the context of geography and distance. This chapter explores where and who produces our food, and how we think about the spaces between them. While we will consider the speed of food delivery, we will also explore the complete absence of food delivery in such areas now defined as food deserts. We'll also review new foods, who makes them, and where our farms may be in the future. We've become obsessed with distance, sometimes only perceived distance, but mostly the measurable distance between our plates and the source of our food. The idea of a food mile, cooked up by academic studies and government agencies that attempted to quantify the mile, have turned out to have different meanings for different landscapes. Any given food product includes a number of micro-ingredients, some processing, and the additional journeys to packing, distribution, and storage facilities. All of these stops add distance. Chapter 3 takes us to all the activities in the midlands of our food supply chain: processing, packaging, and storage. This chapter bridges the gap between the natural food movement and the realities of processing to ensure our food is safe and nutritious. We should all admit that all of our food is processed at some point. Critics of our food system often decry processed food. But the challenge of serving safe food in a litigious world has raised the stakes for those who want organic, unprocessed food. Shelf life requires some respect, since it allows for more food to remain in the supply chain and less food to go in the waste bin. How will we extend shelf life without synthetic additives? And while we resist hyper-processing of our food, we seem receptive to protein produced in petri dishes, which is processing in extremis. This book will explore these new proteins, but we'll save an in-depth exploration of seafood for a later project. Packaging joins processing as another means for maintaining freshness and extending shelf life, and sending environmentalists into a frenzy while we're at it. The material between our food and our mouths is the protective layer guarding us against contamination and spoilage. Even more than a barrier, a package communicates its contents and carries the brand's message from the producer. And those packages are communicating in smarter and smarter ways, with more and more labels containing digital information that conveys who produced our food and where. Food settles in our landscape, stored around railroad terminals, ports, and industrial parks. grain elevators, warehouses, and cold storage facilities are the silent partners of food logisticians who manage inventories and transportation networks. Some warehouses, such as caves or seafood pounds, are out of sight. Some play strategic roles, storing food supplies in crisis areas or in case of scarcity or environmental disaster. Others hold excess food supplies so prices won't fall below profitability. Innovations like shipping containers have changed the way food is stored in transit. And technology plays a role in most solutions now, from extreme shelf life requirements for the military to remote storage in space. Chapter 4 covers the range of transportation networks that connect our farms to our plates. The routes and their hubs take different forms, from food banks to distribution centers. The location of these hubs is often contingent upon the presence of transportation networks. Even the cattle drovers located their stockyards in close proximity to the railroads in the late 19th century. This chapter explores the four major networks: rail, water, air, and roads, and the networks of the future. Food stored on blimps or in space stations isn't too far off. Chapter 5 explains how the desire and need to follow our food throughout the supply chain has driven the new innovations around sensors and the Internet of Things, IoT. It discusses how barcodes, scanners, RFIDs, and GPS technologies are merging to provide shippers and consumers a pathway back to the producer, sometimes in real time. Food fraud, security, and safety create an even more urgent need to develop cost-effective tracking technology to locate food contaminations and counterfeiters in the shortest time possible. The recent obsession with blockchain as the new killer app for the food supply chain may indeed create a new option for tracking and tracing the food in our supply chain. We'll discuss how it works and how some companies are testing out blockchain technology, arguably the most dynamic and potentially transforming link in our evolving future food supply chain. The arrival of new technologies, such as blockchain, and the integration of food supply chain data will transform the food supply chain. With more transparency and collaboration, the food supply chain will be smarter, faster, safer, and able to move food to more people at less cost and with less food waste. Feeding cities will be less miraculous and more predictable, saving resources all along the way. This is the root premise of this book. By the time you reach Chapter 6, you'll be ready to take the ideas discussed in the previous chapters to imagine two versions of your food universe. One is an evolutionary future that uses digital tools alongside our traditional food system to improve transparency, quality, and access. The second future is revolutionary, abandoning our current system for one that is engineered, networked, and nearly independent of livestock and crops grown in fields. Choose your future food system. Will it be insects grown in urban farms delivered by robots? Or hamburgers made from cows outfitted with drones and sensors to improve their health and welfare? Or perhaps, once you've developed a healthy understanding of where food is and where it's going from the first five chapters, you'll be able to anticipate a universe we haven't yet thought of. The important thing to know is that you'll need to make some choices, and they may be more complicated and difficult than you imagine. Those who consume most of the food produced around the world will feel the ramifications of the choices we make now. Developing countries may be the first to feel the impact, since they don't have an existing infrastructure to uproot and replace. They can begin now to implement some of these new technologies, to use data to determine the fastest and cheapest way to deliver fresh food to remote populations. Let's hope we get it right this time. 1. Our food supply chain at a glance. New Yorkers love their pizza slices. They eat them while running down some New York Avenue on the way to work, or even while working, the sauce dripping down their wrists and into their sleeves. Slices became New Yorkers' preferred style of pizza because of the urban lifestyle of Manhattan, with its short lunch hours and mobile culture. The New York pizza slice exists through a serendipitous combination of technological advancements and consumer lifestyles. When Italian immigrants came to New York in the early 20th century, they brought their tomato sauce and flatbreads with them. But back then, the only tools for cooking those flatbreads were wood and coal-fired ovens. At 900 degrees, they were, and still are, too hot to allow for the revered reheated slices. 20 years later, a new baking technology laid the framework for the New York slice, as the arrival of natural gas deck ovens transformed the pizza trade. Now, pizza bakers could use small ovens with low temperatures to reheat single slices. And in the decades following, New Yorkers adopted their slices. The pizza slice perfectly conforms to the needs of New Yorkers, who want a quick lunch they can eat on the run with one hand. That simple slice of pizza can reveal the machinery behind the way our food supply chain works and where it's going. Modern food supply chains are complex systems, juggling many intermediate steps as raw ingredients transform and combine on their way to warehouses, transported by trucks, trains, barges, airplanes, ships, and even bicycles. Sometimes food products are processed several times, cleaned, chopped, packaged, cooked, or combined into sauces, and all in different locations and by different middlemen. There's even a reverse food supply chain with its own logistics. Raw ingredients lurch, sprint, crawl, wait, and gather through a series of transformations called farm to plate. The two is what makes feeding cities possible. The story behind how our global food system evolved could fill several books. The history of agriculture alone deserves a deep dive, since it gives us an idea of how far we've come in terms of how much we can grow on a single acre of land. But in this book, the story about the middle part, the supply chain, and its path from farm to plate, is our hero. Confronting all sorts of monsters and enemies, that chain of events somehow manages to get us fed, more or less, every day. So before we dig into our pizza, let's define what we mean when we talk about food supply chains and logistics, and briefly discuss how they developed into the system that fills our plates today. The evolution of chain logic. Food supply chains consist of a series of linked activities that occur while moving food from producers to consumers. These activities thrive on logistics. Logistics comes from the Greek word logistik, which means the art of planning for the purpose of moving goods and the related organization and equipment. It also relates to a French term, logistique, used by Antoine-Henri de Jomini to describe the practical art of moving armies in The Art of War, 1838. Jomini defined a commissariat as the coordinating center of an army's food supply. He thought of food as an essential fuel for military strategy, and argued that a deficit in an army's food supply would lead to defeat in the field. In that spirit, Jomini laid out the rules for keeping armies fed around supply depots that drew upon the resources of invaded regions. He believed an army would take about a month to occupy a region based upon that region's ability to feed it. So beyond just moving stuff from point A to B, A logistics-based supply chain uses strategy, optimization, operations management, and quantified performance measurements. Today, military and government research projects continue to develop logistics for feeding armies, and the innovations that originate in their labs often find their way to our grocery store shelves, energy bars, for example, or at least our camping supply stores, where we find freeze-dried meals that resemble military meals ready to eat, or snacks originally created for NASA's space station. During the late 19th and early 20th centuries, the newly developed idea of scientific management led to practices that optimized workflow by carefully measuring and maximizing the use of time, labor, and standardized parts and practices while eliminating waste. Frederick Winslow Taylor, an early 20th century mechanical engineer, led the movement, and Taylorism, as his theory was called, led to further improvements in the production and transportation of products from factory to consumer. The idea of optimization became quantifiable, and we began to scientifically optimize the time and distance between farms and plates. When computers arrived during the 1950s and 1960s, the idea of logical, rational workflows got an extra push through the acceleration of data processing, followed by the development of computer-based forecasting and materials planning systems. MIT scientist Jay Forrester led the research that later benefited food processors and manufacturers to improve workflow. It wasn't until the 1980s, however, that supply chain management emerged, leading to supply chain centers in academic institutions. Food logistics acquired its own professional organizations, conferences, and academic departments. Automation joined with scale, large centralized operations, to produce the global food supply system we see today. During the same period, the late 19th and 20th centuries, the development of ice manufacturing and refrigeration led to what is now called the cold chain. The food supply chain differs from other supply chains in its requirement for careful temperature control. Entrepreneurs such as Augustus Swift revolutionized the meat supply chain by utilizing refrigerated rail cars and vertically integrating all aspects of meat production. The arrival of railroads and shipping containers contributed two of the most significant changes in the food supply chain. Railroads began to move food across long distances beginning in the mid-19th century, and shipping containers, developed by Malcolm McLean during the 1950s and 1960s, transformed how food moved on ships, trucks, and trains. The integration of these transport networks eventually became our international intermodal food distribution network. With these new technologies, the industrialization of our food supply gained momentum and became global. Starting in the 19th century, farms and food processing companies grew in size. By the end of the 1800s, companies such as Unilever, General Mills, Nestle, and Campbell's Soup Company represented the emergence of what we now call big food. Back then, size was the optimizer. Centralized facilities and aggregated activities enabled more food to be produced at lower costs. Throughout this period, machinery gained ascendancy over humans as productivity became the objective. Henry Ford discovered that by using assembly lines, he could mass-produce automobiles. Food companies adopted assembly line production practices and industrialized our food system. By World War II, the world's food system had gained more technology and logistics knowledge as a result of the necessities of warfare. Those assembly lines moved faster and produced food manufactured with more ingredients from laboratories than from the soil. We had become experts in producing food at scale, with logistics and supply chains to match. The combination of size and scale with industrialization through the use of science and technology, has given the world record-breaking food production at lower costs. Now all we need to do is distribute all that food while making it more nutritious, maintaining freshness, and increasing access to consumers at all income levels, while minimizing waste and any harmful impact to the environment, including humans. We're on the right path to solving for all this, but not without some unintended consequences. We don't really know yet how food, tech, and humans will accommodate each other. What we do know is that by keeping our eyes on four key ingredients that enable our food supply chain to operate today, we will increase our chances for success. Four ingredients that keep food moving. Unlike many consumer products, such as electronics, food is fragile, emotional, cultural, and apt to expire on the way to our plates. Tacos aren't TVs. Scale and automation have gotten us fed so far, but not without assists from other interrelated ingredients. These are reliability, trust, adaptability, and technology. The path we imagine our food takes to get to our plates is very often different from the real story. Our nonprofit organization in Austin, Texas, Food and City, tells stories of how the food supply chain works in a small magazine that often contains a roadmap for all the ingredients in a recipe or a simple food item, such as pizza. Turns out, it's never really a simple roadmap. It's full of log jams, detours, and dead ends. And those maps point to the four essential ingredients that keep our food flowing to our plates, illustrating how reliability, trust, technology, and adaptability overcome these obstacles. These four ingredients are evident in all the stories in this book, and they will drive the design for our future food supply chains and distribution networks. After visiting cities all over the world to learn about how food supply chains work for the simplest meals, I discovered that no matter how simple or sophisticated the supply chain, every link required our four ingredients in service of one common goal: to transport food from farm to table quickly, inexpensively, and sustainably while ensuring food safety. These ingredients enable our food to move from producer to consumer and interact in ways that optimize the system that delivers our food to our tables. Simple menu items can reveal how those who work in the supply chain business optimize a complex system by leveraging these ingredients. Reliability. Logistics experts in every part of our food supply chain strive for consistency and reliability. Reliability is requisite because consumers expect some degree of consistency in products they consume. They expect price comparisons based on comparable characteristics. A kilo of walnuts should contain walnuts of consistent size, texture, and taste. And those few slightly brown bananas hidden at the bottom of the fruit basket will probably move to the waste bin. A reliable supply chain allows for consistent pricing and quality, which helps meet consumer expectations and minimize food waste. Commuters who head to Joe's Pizza Shop won't pay $20 a slice, nor will they eat a margarita slice that has rubbery crust one day and a perfectly crisp crust the next. And that slice had better be the same size day after day. Reliability and consistency dovetail with predictability. Procurement managers expect food deliveries to show up at their loading docks on schedule. Air cargo brokers need that fresh Alaskan salmon to be ready and sufficiently packed for planned flight schedules. Spontaneity doesn't cohabit with reliability much, and when it happens, it costs. When a food supply chain is reliable, it can minimize the risks and waste involved in delivering food to cities. Joe's Pizza provides a rich landscape for an exploration of our food supply chain. Grain, oil, meat, vegetables, and cheese converge on one menu item, offering stories of how multiple ingredients travel through the supply chain. The late Salvatore Reggio opened Pizza Suprema, a shop located just outside Madison Square Garden, in 1964. Now his wife Maria and their son Joe operate the shop, delivering hot slices to commuters who spill out of Penn Station. I visited with Joe and Maria, meeting them one lunch hour as they sat working through invoices and other paperwork in a corner booth at the back of their pizza shop. Maria is petite, bright, and alert. Her eyes constantly scan the shop, signaling her waitstaff to clear used plates and glasses, and watching for napkins left behind by hurried lunchtime customers. Joe is built like a wrestler. In fact, he does wrestle, but only as a hobby. Now he's a family man, returning to the family business. Both Joe and Maria are meticulous in the ways they choose to optimize their business. Before our pizza begins its journey to Joe's shop, he has to order the ingredients through a process called procurement. He decides what to purchase, whom to purchase it from, and at what price. If he is lucky and smart, he can keep just the right amount of pizza ingredients moving in the supply chain without waste and added expense. If he isn't so smart and fails to optimize his operations, moldy cheese piles up in warehouses and coolers, and those Penn Station commuters move on to Joe's competitors. Technologies, from warehouse management systems that include artificial intelligence for predictive inventory supplies to scanning and tracking tools that help manage shipments of ingredients, play into Joe's ability to sustain his business for all these years in New York City's very competitive food service industry. Sourcing, as procurement is often called, can be local or global, and draws upon technology, trust, and reliability. Joe buys his flour from General Mills, grown in North Dakota, and milled in Buffalo, New York. The flour, called All Trumps 50111, is enriched with potassium, iron, potassium bromate, thiamine mononitrate, riboflavin, and folic acid, and it is a blend of wheat and malted barley flour. It's perfect for pizza, and it utilizes individual supply chains for all those enrichments. He gets pecorino cheese from Italy and mozzarella cheese from Wisconsin. His Stanislaus tomatoes come from California through a food service distributor, probably Sysco. Having multiple sources for an ingredient that's critical to his operation can lower risks and costs, but it adds complexity to tracking and food safety verification. And that's where trust comes in. Trust. Trust comes with experience, as we learn from our own friendships. Food suppliers rely on the transit of assets and funds in exchange for products humans consume. Relationships, as with many business exchanges, are critical when it comes to food, since one bad apple could kill someone. Not only is food safety a requirement for the supply chain to operate successfully, but the delivery of quality and quantity across the globe is also much easier and more efficient when you know whom you're dealing with. Sometimes trust will even trump convenience or price. One sesame seed buyer in Istanbul, Turkey, buys his seeds from Nigeria, from a man he has done business with for more than 20 years, rather than buy seeds from an unknown producer in his own country. And Mustafa, the owner of a fish and chips shop on Farringdon Street in London, depends upon close ties in the Turkish immigrant fish and chips community for all his supplies. He's not alone. Many of the fish and chips shops I visited in the UK rely on Turkish suppliers for ingredients and equipment, since the trust among Turkish business owners runs deep and allows transactions to flow smoothly, often based on just a handshake. Fortunately for Joe, years of working in the pizza business has also built relationships that run deep. trusted networks of suppliers come from years of trading employees, stepping in for one another when problems arise, keeping secrets, and obeying the rules of credit and other financial transactions. Joe gets his ingredients using the operation of food supply chains we've had for decades. He may decide to purchase cheese at a higher price from a local farmer because he wants to support local businesses. He may also decide to buy cheese from Italy at a higher price because Italy is the only source of that particular cheese. Or he may choose to purchase cheese thousands of miles away at a lower cost because the product he sells is price sensitive. Joe trusts his suppliers, and his customers trust that he will find the best ingredients at the best cost so that their pizzas will continue to be safe, tasteful, and affordable. The people sourcing our food rely on those trusted relationships that determine the resiliency of the supply chain. Our food supply chain will continue to rely on trusted relationships between farmers and buyers, and between product companies and processors. If the four ingredients, principles, not the kind Joe puts in his pizzas, are important to keep our food moving along the supply chain under regular conditions, they become absolutely critical when things go wrong. During my visit to Pizza Suprema, we talked about Hurricane Sandy, which hit New York City in 2012, disrupting everything. The shop closed for 4 days, limited mostly by the lack of power. For the pizza man, the first thing to go wrong in a power outage is the cheese inventory. Flour, canned tomatoes, spices, and olive oil can last for weeks. But cheese goes bad in days, even 4 days. To make matters worse, Joe's cheese supplier, Grande, couldn't get its trucks to his shop because of road closures and traffic. Of course, even if the trucks could have gotten through, the lack of power would have spoiled the shipments. Keeping the shop running would require another of our key ingredients, adaptability. So Joe called up his pizza business friend in Brooklyn, who still had power, and he got some shredded cheese to replace the cheese normally delivered from his supplier in Wisconsin. That adaptability is an example of the flexibility and durability that allows the supply chain to get food to our plates in spite of interruptions and breakdowns. By acquiring the cheese from his Brooklyn friend, Joe was able to resume his business in 4 days, which is a miracle considering that some New Yorkers were still, in 2013, not back to business as usual. Even business as usual belies the complications of delivering a simple menu item and illustrates how those four ingredients operate to keep the supply chain moving. There's a deli in Austin that makes a ridiculously delicious club sandwich. The store in Austin is part of Jason's Deli, a chain of 275 delis located in 28 states. A few years ago, a group of students at the University of Texas at Austin worked with Food and City to track down the supply chain for the sandwich and found that the ingredients traveled to its delis from several countries, including Finland. Jason's Deli Club Sandwich consists of bread, ham, Swiss and cheddar cheeses, bacon, lettuce, and tomatoes. But each ingredient in the sandwich includes micro-ingredients, just like the flour General Mills makes for Joe's Pizza. The students found that the bread alone had its own complex path from wheat field to deli. And Jason's story is similar to the stories of bread produced in other countries. Wheat farmers in Kansas grew the wheat, which was sent by rail to a mill that distributed the ground wheat to bakeries. Other ingredients, such as water, yeast, flaxseed, wheat gluten, and sugar, also found their way to the bakeries. The flaxseed came from Nebraska, the wheat gluten from Poland, and the sugar from sugarcane grown in Georgia and Louisiana. The flow of all these micro-ingredients needed to converge at a bakery that produced the bread. Then the bread would travel onward through a distribution system that eventually landed in a single Jason's Deli location for for assembly into a sandwich. The mustard, too, contained micro-ingredients, including mustard seeds, oil, and salt. And the theme continued across every part of the sandwich. Each ingredient consisted of several micro-ingredients. Each micro-ingredient had its own supply chain. And if just one of those chains broke down, the whole sandwich would have to be reconsidered. Fortunately, the supply chain is incredibly adaptable, both positively and negatively, for finding substitutions and adulterations. Adaptability. Jason's supply chain requires sublime adaptability, reliability, trust, and technology to operate successfully. If one rail car gets sidetracked by a snowstorm, the wheat will mold. Or if longshoremen decide to strike at Houston's port, the wheat gluten from Poland and the cheese from Finland won't be able to enter the United States through trusted brokers. Even when our four key ingredients are present, they don't always lead to success. Failure to deliver food happens. The unobstructed, easy flow of the supply chain is the aim of everyone in the global food system. If we could achieve our goal, we'd grow exactly enough healthy food to exactly match the individual demand of all consumers, so food waste would cease to exist. The reason this hasn't yet been achieved is because of friction within the machinery of the food supply chain. Friction points are points that cause the supply chain to halt, break, leak, or misdirect our food. Understanding these friction points may help us eliminate, or at least lubricate them. Friction points include traffic and urban congestion, broken equipment, labor strikes, decaying transportation networks, including potholes in roads, wars, theft, electrical outages, climate changes, and trade sanctions. Any one of these conditions puts pressure on the supply chain to adapt and to recreate reliability. The ability of the supply chain to adapt is critical to overcoming many of these friction points. Derailed trains? Trucks might suffice. Ports closed? Ships may enter through alternative ports, and their cargo could travel to their original destinations in trucks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.